SQL Server 2019 provides a new feature for Linux called persistent log buffers. It was available for Windows before, now it is on Linux as well, and it helps you to eliminate bottlenecks that might occur when waiting for the log buffer to flush to disk. Brian is here to tell us all about it today on Data Exposed. Hi, and welcome to another episode of Data Exposed. I'm your host, Jeroen, and today I have Brian with me to talk about persistent log buffers in SQL 2019. So, hey, Brian, welcome to the show.
Hey, Jeroen. Thank you.
So, what are we going to talk about? Persistent log buffers?
Yes.
So what is that?
So, persistent log buffer is one of what we call the in-memory database feature family, which includes in-memory OLTP, persistent log buffer, which I'll demonstrate today, sometimes called tail of log caching,
okay,
a data and log file enlightenment in Linux, hybrid buffer pool in Linux and Windows, and memory optimized tempdb metadata.
Okay, cool.
And so I'll just mention quickly about persistent memory devices. A lot of people haven't seen them, but essentially these are regular DIMMs that you fit into your server.
Okay.
That come in different capacities. NVDIMM-N, which is one type of persistent memory technology, comes in 8, 16, or 32 gig DIMM capacity. And then the latest Intel Optane DC persistent memory comes in much higher capacities of 128, 256 gigabytes, or 512 gigabyte DIMMs.
That's a lot of persistent memory.
Wow. Yes. So you can, on an 8-socket server, you can support up to 24 terabytes of persistent memory. So
and you can unlock all of that with this persistent log buffer, right?
Correct.
Wow. Okay.
Persistent log buffer is designed to solve a particular use case where you were incurring slowdowns or waits in your workload, waiting for the log buffer that is in memory to flush to disk.
Okay.
So it uses the persistent memory device, and it knows that it once it's written to that device, that it doesn't need to wait for the flush because it's already on a persistent device.
And then the device will take care of the rest.
Yes, the device will then take care of the rest while you carry on,
cool,
essentially with your workload.
Yeah.
So when you're setting up these devices in Windows, we have some basic recommendations that you lock pages in memory. Use a 2 megabyte allocation unit size for NDFS, which won't be the default.
Okay.
Also, you need to set this flag DAX. So DAX is really what enables us to treat a persistent memory device and write to it directly, skipping all of the kernel stack that you would typically need when dealing with files.
Mm-hmm.
Won't be available in the GUI, so you will need to use some PowerShell for this.
Okay, all right. You'll show us how this works. Right?
Yes,
okay.
I will show how these get configured. Also, some of your OS level disk counters that you may be used to looking at, like disk transfers and so forth, may not be available to you when you're working with persistent memory devices.
That's okay.
Just one of the things you need to be aware of.
Sure.
These are new devices, and this is very brand new, exciting tech.
Okay.
So there may be some catching up to do on the monitoring side.
Sure.
For Linux, non-volatile device control is the utility that you use to configure these. You would set it to FS DAX mode. Use 2 megabyte huge page faults. Set your block allocation also to 2 megabytes. We support XFS or EXT4 for these are two supported file systems with DAX.
Okay.
So persistent log buffer, this has been available actually in SQL since SQL 2016.
Okay.
Only for Windows until now. With SQL 2019, we also have this feature now available in Linux as well as Windows. It uses only a very small amount of capacity. The log buffer is only 20 megabytes per user database.
Okay.
So it really doesn't take up a huge amount of capacity.
Mm-hmm.
And the behavior that you get is very similar to forcing delayed durability.
Okay.
So you don't, again, you're not waiting for that log flush to
right.
happen to disk, but incurs none of the risks that you take with forced delayed durability around data loss.
So can you tell us a little bit more about forced delayed durability for those that are
sure,
not
for
not
those,
necessarily aware of it?
Yes, for those who are not familiar, this is essentially an asynchronous commit mechanism in
right.
SQL Server.
Okay.
So it There are a couple of ways to do it. One is allowed, in which case your normal commits happen as you expect. You wait for the flush, wait for them to be hardened on disk, or in a forced mode where all commits behave like this.
Okay.
So with allowed, you specify on a per commit basis if you want this behavior, and it's allowed. Disallowed, which is the default, doesn't matter what you have in there, it's not going to happen.
Sure.
And then forced, all commits behave this way.
Okay, so and the persistent log buffer is very similar, but not entirely the same.
Very similar, but not entirely the same. Because we have the persistent memory device,
right,
we put our log buffer on there, and once we write to there, we know that it's persisted, and we don't have any risk of data loss. If,
okay.
In the event of a server crash, power failure, anything of that nature, we can recover from the data on the persistent memory device.
Okay, cool.
And it's actually quite simple. A lot of mm-hmm. people don't realize. You simply add a log file of 20 megabytes on the persistent memory device. SQL Server will recognize this device and will treat it as the log buffer.
And it's really, that simple.
Really that simple.
Wow.
Yeah, and as we can see here, our log buffer is sitting on our storage class memory, which is PMEM. Sometimes we call it storage class memory in some places, but same thing. And our log records are there, and we don't, as I mentioned, we don't have to wait for them to be flushed to the main transaction log file.
Mm-hmm. Cool.
So I'll just switch quickly to my demo here.
Yep.
And first I'll just show that we have configured here our persistent memory devices. As I mentioned, these are regular DIMMs. You can see the device IDs there. Yep. And we've configured two devices, one per NUMA node,
okay,
interleaved across the devices, DIMMs on that NUMA node. So this is the recommended way that we say to set it up.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. And again, we can see that our DAX value is enabled. It's set to true here. And if we want to use our older command line type utility, we can just get that little bit more info here. And we can see that we have set the allocation unit size to two megabytes.
As you just described, it should be.
Yeah, mm-hmm. As I just described, and quite simple. We just add the log file, as I mentioned, and we just create it. And regardless of what size you put in here, we'll actually only create use 20 megabytes, but just go ahead and say 20 megabytes. It's it's really that simple.
Wow. Okay, so that's impressive. So basically, I can unlock all this new tech with the persistent log buffer by just running a very simple command, right? Sure, you have to configure the device first. But after that's done in SQL, you just add a log.
Yeah, and it's really this type of technology is really enabling a new tier of storage, helping remove some of the traditional bottlenecks that we see in SQL Server and high-end workloads.
Right, so big innovation, but then done in a very simple manner for the user and for the configuration,
yes, right? We build the intelligence into SQL Server to recognize these devices and behave accordingly.
Yeah, very cool. Well, thanks for sharing.
Thank you.
I think this was very useful, very interesting, at least to me. I hope this was useful and interesting to you as well. Please subscribe, like, comment on the video, and I hope to see you next time on another episode of Data Exposed. Thanks.